That ain't right.
And welcome to the Hit Back. I'm your host, Laneisha Black. It is a beautiful day here in the 242. We got a lot to talk about today. We've got, of course, it's a regular wealthy Wednesday. So we will at the 5 o'clock hour, though, instead of 4:30 today, because we got a bit of things in the news to discuss. We will be having our wealthy Wednesday, sort of our educational series, our financial literacy series at 5 o'clock. And we're going to be talking about basic investing 101 investment guide. And we will continue part two of that next week. But we got to start off today with the news, right? So the news, in the news, there's a lot to digest. There's a lot in the news. Yesterday's show was lit as usual. Some of you saw me last night on my good friend Clint's show last night as well. Listen, there always is something. We are now into the silly season. The big news yesterday was Laneisha Rolle, her bowing out. We've learned that it was a forced resignation, that she got a call by the information from her father. She got a call from Carl Bethel, the attorney general, letting her know that, hey, listen, the prime minister is not going to renominate you. And also that you are not, he would prefer that you leave the office, in essence, of the cabinet minister, the minister of youth, sports and culture. What we have gathered also out of that news is the is that there is, or there was, an audit. We see today further details coming out of the Tribune with regard to the extent of the audit. When was the audit commissioned? The date by which the prime minister had heard that there were some alleged discrepancies with accounting from the NSA, saying that there were some issues with procedure and protocol with regard to taking funds out of the NSA, the proper channels were not happening. That went to the prime minister, and then it led to this. Well, I had gotten further information from other sources that the prime minister and the minister of youth were not corresponding, that they were not connecting, that from the Ministry of Youth, Sports and Culture, the minister was trying to reach on multiple occasions the prime minister, and that there was no discourse. And this was before these announcements, right? So that there has been some challenges within that ministry with regard to Minister Rolle, and hence why you can hear now with that information that I've gotten today was why, when you hear the father of the minister, with the way he speaks, is as if he was speaking from a place where he realizes that there was a issue. And the word that I got yesterday was that the minister feels as if this was purely personal. So there's a lot to digest with this, and we will have to see, because there's a lot of information now coming out, right? And you always have to wonder where things are leaked. In sports, they always tell you, if you're getting a lot of information from a particular camp about someone, for or against, look where it's coming from. If a quarterback wants an increase, they'll say that the quarterback is unhappy. That is coming from the quarterback's camp. Yeah. If the team wants to get rid of someone, they start talking about how difficult that person is. But it won't. It will come from that camp, because now we're trying to negotiate and create leverage, get our story out first. So this is what is going on. And be mindful of where the story is coming out. OK, be mindful of where the story is coming out. But after the show, ladies and gentlemen, after yesterday's show, my show yesterday, when I left the studio, I got a voice note. I got a news clip. And when I heard the news clip, I paused. Because when I got to the end of the clip, I was like, that couldn't have been what I thought I heard. And by now, you all heard what you thought you didn't hear, right? The Minister of Health going on and giving us a very robust description of what he believes is the power of the Prime Minister. Well, that didn't go off so well, because, of course, just like the time Aaron Lewis said, you put your tin tub outside, if you need warm water, go on and bathe outside. Warm that water in the tin tub. In essence, he didn't really say that, but that's what we got from it. There's jokes galore, right? I think we've had the good minister for my Cal having challenges, saying numbers were bigger than four digits. So we've had our challenges, right? But this morning, and this is one of those things where I think sometimes you've got to learn to just let it go, because it would have been fodder for about like 3 days. We would have laughed about it. Actually, I think after today, we would have laughed about it. especially knowing that there's more information coming out on the resignation and the audit, right? We would have moved on.org. We would have. But the minister today decided that he needed to explain what he said. But before we get there, let's go to what he said, because I want this in context. So when you hear the explanation, I would like your response. So this is the minister on his testicular commentary.
We're looking at sort of the end of the week, as was intimated by the Deputy Prime Minister. It is good news. What would make it even better news is when the vaccine lands, that the Bahamian people avail themselves of it to the maximum possible use. The rollout could start as early as next week, could start. But I will leave those up to, I will leave the announcement of such things up to the Honorable Prime Minister, who has been the testicular head and leading the charge in many regards.
All right. So we know judgment now. But when he said testicular head, it was a compliment, right? It wasn't about anything, okay? It was a compliment. I would leave this to our prime minister, who was the testicular head in many regards. Okay, powerful. But today, after all of us joking on him and really, really saying, my brother, what happened? This is what the minister decided to do. The minister decided that he needed to explain to us. And mind you, poor fellow, maybe he did. I don't know. But I would have just left it alone if it was me, because you can't. How can you undo this? But here we go.
I have to ask a quick question. You received a little bit of backlash for your former testimony at cabinet. You said that the prime minister was the testicular head. Any response to the backlash you've been receiving, Kristen, said gone?
Listen, I could take my boss down a little bit. Well, no, then folks will criticize that as well. Yesterday was my birthday, and I ended up in a debate with an older gentleman, a policeman. And this gentleman was quite informed about my political beliefs. And he was a little upset over the fact that I am one of those who believe that the Bahamas should become a republic, which means that we would remove the Queen as our titular head. Titular head of the nation, right? And replace her with a president who would be a president of the Bahamas. So that's the discussion I was in before I came to cabinet, okay? This older gentleman also knew that I was one who's never sworn allegiance to Her Majesty the Queen. If you go back to when I was elected in 2012, I was the only member of this House who affirmed in taking the oath of allegiance to serve the Bahamian people. And in 2017, there was about 6 or 7 persons who also affirmed, some because of religious reasons, others because they also believe that the Bahamas should become a republic, okay? I have always been of that belief all of my adult life, and I have put that forward. You know, those who know my political beliefs knows that I believe that the Queen should not remain as our titular head of the nation. And so that is what I intended to say. And as a result of it, it didn't come out exactly like I intended. And what I wanted to say was that the Prime Minister is more than a titular head of the vaccine, meaning that he is intimately involved making decisions. So that is what I intended to say. But you know, the nation has had a good laugh off of it. It's good that we can all have a light-hearted moment in this country. And so, in a sense, I'm kind of happy that I would have delivered a light-hearted moment to the Bahamian people.
All right, thank you.
Well, I mean, first of all, can I just say, I'm happy that he found that it was a light-hearted moment, and I like it. I mean, hey, let's laugh about it. You're right, because we were already laughing about it. But anybody buying that story, that was one heck of a story. Consider how quickly the Minister of Health said this. This wasn't hard to know. What was not hard was that all of that summation, how do you miss and say that we leave it to the prime minister, who is our testicular head in that regard. Meaning he was giving him confidence. He was boosting up and building up this strength of our prime minister, calling out his jockstrap in essence. This is the strength, the manhood. Just didn't know how to say it, right? Went, tried to be Negro poetic. It didn't work out. It just didn't work out. But to come back today and call the Bahamian people a national conk, right? Because we must be the national conk to buy that bit of scorch conk he was selling. We must be the vendors to consume. We must be the consumers to sell, to buy what he's selling. Because that, no. What? All of that? You understand how terrible all of that had to be? That you would have to start out with, it was my birthday. Like, first of all, happy birthday, Minister. I must say, happy belated birthday. You and Shanique Miller share a very auspicious month with myself, who is also a Pisces. And so, happy birthday, Minister. But boo, we ain't falling for that story. That was a long story. Started off, it was my birthday. And then I was having a conversation with a gentleman. And y'all know from Jump Street, I was against the Queen. And first of all, he couldn't even say titular. He had to say titicular. It was getting a little difficult. It was tough. Good minister. I really don't know what to say here other than nice try though. Man, nice try. All of that to say, I really screwed up. I really screwed up. I really screwed. It was just a bad phrasing. And, you know, I'm glad everybody laughed at it. Obviously, I didn't mean for that to happen. It was just really bad. And I think the fact that to make up such a large story, mind you, I don't believe that the story's made up. So don't even say that. But to try and change what you were saying, because what he said was.
We're looking at sort of the end of the week, as was intimated by the Deputy Prime Minister.
It is. We're talking about vaccines.
What would make it even better news is when the vaccine lands, that the Bahamian people avail themselves of it to the maximum possible use. The rollout could start as early as next week. Could start.
Listen for any reference to the Queen and leadership.
The announcement of such things up to the Honorable Prime Minister, who has been the testicular head and leading the charge in many regards.
The brother talking about the size of the Prime Minister's strength. He ain't talking about no Queen. He ain't trying to talk about he is not a titular head. How you can move from a positive in the initial statement to say you meant for it to be a negative in the next statement, to say that he was not a titular head, because of course he couldn't have meant that the prime minister was a titular head, because to be a titular head, ladies and gentlemen, is holding or constituting a purely formal position or title without any real authority. Well, if he had said that, but we know Minister Wells would be right on the side of the road with Madam Laneisha Rolle, KP to Turnquest, and Dwayne Sands. So he obviously didn't mean this, but to try and, I felt for him. I felt for him. Listen, my brother, own up that you were trying to give the prime minister a lot of strength, that you were going to say that my prime minister's jockstrap is so large. He has the testicular fortitude to give you all the vaccine, perhaps, but to come back this morning and think we are the conks of conks. I know conk going through a little bit of, you know, scarcity issue based on data, right? But come on, man, we can't be the queen and king conks, the grand conks of the Bahamas, to believe that today that is the story and the narrative. The good minister, really. Now, mind you, some have argued that it may have been a Freudian slip. It can't be no slip, man. You testicular head. I just can't. But nonetheless, I think the worst part of all of this now is not just the statement, not just the misspeaking, because it could be forgiven. You know, words can be forgiven. Words can, not all words, but people misspeak sometimes. People say things that they don't mean to say. And, you know, just listen, I don't know what I was thinking. This is what I really was thinking. And I just screwed up on it. You know, I really wanted just to explain to the Bahamian people that this, my prime minister, our leader, has been very strong. He has been decisive. And we leave that into his great hands, his testicular head hands. But we leave it in his hands. But this comeback and, you know, wheel selector come again. Someone says I'm trying to save him. I really am trying because it doesn't, I mean, what is this? I don't know what's going on. Says, oh, where to go, Hughley. So I, you know, good minister, I don't know what you were trying to do, my brother. It didn't work. All I know is it didn't work. And, you know, Jesus on the throne, because child, that ain't work, you know? That did not work. Oh, my goodness. Okay. Also, we're going to be talking something else on the other side of breaks. Let me move to titular, because the brother couldn't even say titular. He had to say titular and then tried it again. So you know he wasn't trying to say titular. You wonder if he even knew. But he said he had a conversation. So bless his heart. Bless his heart, minister. Bless your heart. We see you. Lord, have mercy. Let's just stick to policy and written speeches. I really do appreciate your effort in trying to come back with this conch shell story. But we ain't buying that. You can keep that scotch conch for yourself. That's dried conch. Dried conch. Keep it for yourself. I don't eat dried conch. Salty. All right. So someone says, as long as he pronounced it right when he ordered the vaccine. You can imagine if he tried to order our vaccine and couldn't get the pronunciation right. We might have gotten a Russian one, but I digress. That's not funny. All right, we got a lot of other stuff to talk about today. Plus, don't forget, on 5 o'clock, we are going to have joining us, right? Yeah, is it, at worst, it's a gaffe. It happens all the time. You're right, it happens all the time. Just let it go. We have on the other side of the break, we have to discuss. There's some two things that have been very interesting. And we got a call on the line. So let me get the caller, and then I'll tell you what has been interesting with today in the House of Assembly. Caller, you're on the Hitback. Welcome.
Yes, Hitback. How are you?
I'm doing well, and you?
Fine. I mean, for me, really, we got more important things to talk about in this radio for that, right? That's a straightforward issue. I mean, if he used the word, he may have pronounced it wrong, and he explained it, so that's fine.
No. He didn't pronounce it wrong.
Yeah, but my point is, we shouldn't be reading into so many things that it's not what it is. You know, these are other things to talk about this country.
Okay, well, so give me something then. You called me for something. Give me something what you want us to talk about.
Well, no, I just said, let's talk about reform, energy reform. Let's talk about other industries we could create. Maybe some form of taxation, different forms of taxation, you know.
Well, stay tuned. The show does this on many occasions. The show, we do that on many occasions. This is something that I wanted to discuss at the beginning of the show, but I appreciate you. I appreciate you, my brother. I thank you so much for the call.
Man. It's more constructive stuff, man.
Thank you, man. I appreciate you. All right. I think it's fascinating. Everybody was more constructive. I got you. But that's what I wanted to leave the show with. What was led by the show on the show was that same thing right there. All right. So something else that's going to be very interesting, based on what the speaker did in the House today, that I thought was fascinating in the House. So the speaker now is independent. As an independent speaker, has decided to do something that I actually am looking forward to be honest. I'm looking forward to how the speaker is handling himself, right? He made a move with strength today. The speaker made a move with strength today. And the move with strength that he made was to actually say that the government can no longer ignore or do its best to try and avoid question and answers. That is a big deal because there are points of order. Points of order, right? Points of order on what to do or, you know, things that have to happen in the process. And you don't worry about that. People don't face, you know, that's small things. Points of order that happens in the House of Assembly. And for many times, many, many moments, this government has refuse to go through the process of doing or dealing with question and answers. When we come back on the other side of the break, I want to explain to you how important what the Speaker of the House did today and setting a standard. This is going to be good having an independent speaker. I'm really excited with this. And so I'm looking forward to this side of it. But, you know, everybody want to tell women what to do on a given day. I need to do this, that, and the other. But we digress. We'll be back right after this. You're listening to The Hit Back with Laneisha Black. We'll be back right after this.
Boy, why you look so mashed up, like clothes at the washer?
No, boy, just a hard day, boy.
Hard day? What happened? The breakfast lady ran out of tune and gritsy.
We need to start joking with everything, you know. This serious, boy. This really serious, boy.
Boy, what's serious? Tell me.
All right, well, today, boss gave us boy a big, big contract. And nobody else get a chance and nobody say nothing.
Boy, you know that ain't right. You know government contracts ain't supposed to go that way.
Yeah, but nobody saying nothing. Boss man just tell people to sign the papers. Then he send me to meet his boy downtown and collect this envelope.
You need to tell somebody. You need to become a whistleblower.
You know I's a real man, but I never blow no whistle. I be drunk all my life in Junkano.
No way. A whistleblower is someone who tells people what they see when they see something wrong happening at work.
But I ain't no whistleblower, and I ain't no snitch. I still wait there, you know.
But ain't nobody gonna know it's you. All you gotta do is call Crime Stoppers, or you could text them from inside the Crack Crime Bahamas app. They don't ask about you, and your call goes straight through to Miami, so nobody know you is. And if you text, your message get mixed up like Kong Salad.
Call 308-8477 from Nassau, or 242-300-8477 from the Family Islands.
For the past 33 years, Great Commission Ministries has been defending the poor and hurting, feeding the hungry, and sheltering the homeless. We invite you to support our Live to Give program and make a difference in these challenging times. Become a donor by giving a one-time annual gift or a monthly donation of $50 or $100. Call Great Commission Ministries at 325-5801 for more details, or visit our headquarters at 237 Wolf Road. Join Live to Give today. This public service announcement is proudly sponsored by this radio station.
Hey! Got to pay back! Revenge! Some get back, payback, payback, that is, payback, again, I'm mad, to get down with my girlfriend, that ain't right.
And we're back. You're listening to The Hit Back with Laneisha Black. Okay, we got a lot of texts. We got a lot of calls. Caller, you're on The Hit Back. Welcome.
Yeah, how you doing?
I'm doing well, my brother. What you say?
You know, I can imagine that same gentleman trying to give an excuse for Judas after what he did to Jesus. I mean...
No, it's more important things to talk about, man.
But here's what I think happened, though. I think the good minister was talking to Jeff Lloyd, and Jeff Lloyd was throwing all those big words at him, and he came out and tried to mimic what Jeff was saying, and just saying something that didn't make any sense. Just like how his excuse today didn't make any sense. But these judges need to come out and just speak plainly to the people so we can understand exactly what they're saying. That should be part of accountability, right? Better say exactly what we can understand.
Yeah.
Right?
Well, it would be nice, wouldn't it? Just speak plainly. Plainly.
As for the Speaker of the House, I think he's putting the current government in a bad position. They actually have to be accountable now.
Yeah.
He's doing a job. It took him over almost 4 years, but, you know, I guess better late than never.
Listen, better late than never.
Driver and that free car and gas and his office with no taller facilities. He's earning that money right now. So,
I'm impressed with the speaker that he's holding these folks accountable. Thank you, my brother. I appreciate it. You can feel free to give us a call, 325-4259, 325-4316. You can also text us at 323-6232. Caller, you're on the air. Yes, welcome. Yes.
Hello. Thank you for taking my call.
How you doing?
I would like to perhaps make a correlation between the recent resignation and the minister's statement. And here's how I want to give it to you in a picture. Like, let's suppose I'm CEO of a company and I have this female who works for me and I'm in love with her. And she feels as though she could get away with it, I mean, just about anything. When I find out she has, I got to have the testicular hair to get rid of her. Got it?
No.
You don't get it? I go on then. I can see you later.
Listen, there is nothing right about that phrase. Unless it's a whole other kettle of fish. Caller, you're on the hit back. Welcome.
Nahaja, how are you?
I'm doing well, and you?
Wonderful, not bad at all.
Good.
Listen, Nahaja, I thought she knew that the minister, Renard Wells, was a fast-talking, card-shuffling snake oil salesman. You act like you didn't know. You know,
I like the minister.
Him being a fast talker has gotten him to the top of the ladder. You know, on top of that, you know, him thinking that the Bahamian people are conks, that he could fast talk us and out talk us every time with all these fancy words and stuff. It is finally catching up with him. And even when he makes mistakes, he comes back and tries to still force it on you that you are so stupid and you've been beaten with the mallet so long that you will not understand that he made a mistake. But he's just a fast talker, and he hasn't just became that. He has always been that. Just wanted to let you know.
Thank you, my brother. And that's it. Listen, it was just a mistake. Own the mistake. Say, I made a mistake. Actually, better than that, just not mention the mistake at all. It's just, it was a joke. And our reporter, Bethany asked, I was surprised that we even asked that question, but it was funny. Okay, we got a bunch of texts. Malapropism, look up the word. It explains what happened with Wells. Many, many of our speakers and countrymen are guilty of it. Put simply, he does not know the meaning of titular. All right. Someone says is he saying only the PM has testicles in the house? Hi. One live coverage of every moment of the vaccines when they reach our island, drone coverage. He mentioned that. Yeah. Y'all got jokes. If only they could take the time like that to explain real issues. Please give me a break. Ask him what size minis boxes is. Y'all wrong, eh? Someone says, you talk show hosts are sad. Minister Wells came from R.M. Bailey. He's making Bailey look bad. I'm a graduate of R.M. Bailey. Proud Pacer. All right. Someone thanks the caller. Hi, was that Wells boy? Oh, Lord. Someone says, I believe his explanation. Listen, it happens. And that's, I don't believe all of that explanation. It cannot happen. But nonetheless, it was funny. And for those who wish not to laugh on it, then it is what it is. It is what it is. And, you know, funny thing is, when we start talking about serious things in this country, serious things, which we always talk about on the show is not new to serious issues. Many of the issues that come through the show end up in the news. So please don't insult my intelligence or the value of this show by talking about, you know, we must talk serious issues. The truth of the matter is, when we speak on serious issues, there are many who still don't like the tenor of the conversation on the serious issues, because the serious issues must follow a narrative that best suits your end result or goal. I'm not here to assuage many people's desire to have pats on the back. The reality of it is that there are people in this country who were middle class a year ago, who are now standing on lines, who are now facing poverty, not facing it, but are one last bill cycle from finding themselves living in their cars. So let's not have this debate on what is serious and what is not serious. What is serious has been serious for more than 10 years. What has been serious? So this aggrandizing of oneself, huh? This building up of oneself and becoming holier than thou in the moment. Save it for someone else. Don't bring it to me. Because the truth of the matter is, we have been living in this mess. Bahamian people have been living in this mess whilst politicians and their cronies have been sitting on the sideline waiting for their 5-year term to reach so that they can rape and pillage the nation's purse. So don't come to me or for me talking foolishness on your high horse about what is the what should be said, because what has been said every day on this show is we are better than where we are. What is the insult is when people will tell you as if we're being gaslight. Is it this the gaslighting that happens from these politicians? And I'm sorry, this administration has failed the Bahamian people to no regard. I mean, constantly we find ourselves having to come back and rewind selector. Did you say what you say? It was my prime minister who I voted for in Kalani, who sat in the House, who stood up in the House and said that there were times when our rights, our civil rights will have to be taken away. Our constitutional rights for what greater good? So please. Please save me all of this altruistic foolishness. Save me all of this sensibility. The reality is there was a gaffe. The reality is it wasn't just any gaffe. It was my minister of health who spoke something in regard to my prime minister that made no sense and that actually was speaking about the penis. So come, liven up, wake up. Ain't got time for your pity party and patting yourself on the back because you feel special today. Save it. The reality is people are struggling. The reality is people are hurting. And some days you got to give them a laugh. Some days you got to give them a break. And really, if it's at the expense of the very people who are responsible for the challenges we are facing and not being able to manage it well, then so let it be. I ain't gonna lose no skin off of my bones and teeth because this thing, I ain't got no time for that. So now, with that said, we now move into the House of Assembly, right? Into the House of Assembly today, we had the mid-year budget. The mid-year budget is a big deal. The Prime Minister had a good conversation, and you know, we were hoping that we would get from it a little bit more meat for the bones. But I actually, as I was reading it, I realized that I wanted more time with it because when we talk about the budget, I really want to know exactly the details in it. But I was very happy with all of that. What was said now giving us more meat for the bones, par for the course, because this is where it gets interesting. We are in the mid-year budget. I was told yesterday after the show, Nahaja, there's not going to be a call for an early election, but I don't know if I believe that. I really don't know if I believe that, but let's see. Why does that matter? Because that means that this budget and this cycle has to pan out for this administration. It has to pan out for us as a people. It has to, all right? It has to pan out. So if it has to pan out, we need to have real structure. We need to have real accountability. And if we are doing audits or doing audits to release them just to affect people within our sector to get people out, then we're not doing the audits for the right reason. The audits should be made public. Every audit should be made public. Every audit. It's fascinating that we're hearing about an audit for Laneisha Rolle. But what about other audits? Who else has been audited that we don't know about? Where are the other audits? So again, we can get built into a tizzy. And I always say, take your time, enjoy it for the moment, but then now step back and look at it as a whole, as a part of the picture. What is really going on? Right? What is really going on? So now we have these things in the House of Assembly. We have the mid-year budget. I will next week, because this weekend I'm not paying attention to anything going on with this country for this weekend. I don't care. But next week when I get back to work, we're going to look at this mid-year budget and really get a sense of it, because that's all that matters, really. That's all that matters. And, you know, as much as the gaslighting, they would tell you what I said, but I didn't say what I said. Whatever. So the speaker now has all of this chutzpah. The speaker is making his waves felt, right? The speaker now is mad. Like, he ain't playing no more. Y'all ain't running over me. Y'all ain't doing what y'all think you could do, blah, blah, blah. You're going to answer the people's questions. Question and answers. Saying that there's nowhere in there but not nowhere in there, but based on the rules of question and answers, that now there must be an accounting. And these questions that are presented on the floor must be answered by the minister responsible for that. And so this is going to be very interesting, which I think will lead us to even more pressing, to press even harder on our members of parliament and our representatives, right? Right. So it makes you press even harder. And I think this is when you use your independent candidates. Who else is independent in the House? Only Reese, eh? I think only Reese Chipman is an independent member. And so we need Reese Chipman, along with the opposition, to now show up and start asking questions. Interestingly, we are seeing the supposed pressure from the Progressive Liberal Party talking about this audit with Laneisha Rolle. There has been a lot of information now that is being leaked out. We have on social media documents that are supposedly of Mrs. Rolle's purchase of land, declaring that it was cash, that it was a cash transaction for land. I don't see any proof of that, but this is now the sort of thing that's traveling and traversing the waves, right? We're seeing her, listen, you should be, it's amazing the things that are coming out now. Now we're seeing her disclosure. Who gave the okay to release her disclosure information? Have we seen the disclosure info, the financial disclosure information of any of the other members of parliament? Have we seen any of them? Look how quickly that leaked out. Look how quickly this leaking has happened. All right? Look how quickly it's happening. And I assure you, it ain't coming from the PLP side of this big leak, you know. Well, I can assure you that. But I would be surprised if it's coming all the way from the PLP side. Something feels a little off with this whole process, right? Could be the PLP, you know, you never know with these guys, but I've never seen them be that great at campaigning. C'est la vie. But this is where it gets interesting to me, that we are seeing all of this. Now all of her financial records, and it does feel begin to feel personal. Now we could see probably why daddy start picketing outside of the office, right? That daddy started picketing, right? He wants to fight for his daughter. And so this is where it gets, all of this is fascinating things for us. So we're going to be watching this as the speaker now is allowed question and answers. Let's see where this question and answer, how this will formulate and change how discussions are done in the House of Assembly. Also, let us keep our eyes and our minds open to what is going to happen with the Public Accounts Committee now that we are hearing about an audit. Right? Now that we're hearing about this audit. So this is where, you know, we want to see if the opposition leader, Brave Davis, will call for this. And so that's where it's going to get fascinating there. Will the opposition leader call for this sort of movement? And that's where it's going to get interesting. So we have a lot of things to see, a lot of things to stay awake for, to see how this process lines up, right? See how this process lines up. There was a case being made that indeed the Prime Minister is showing courage in that he's getting rid of persons who are troublesome. And I said that yesterday. I was told that the Prime Minister is getting rid of troublesome persons, persons who can be problematic, and that he's moving forward with the idea that he can be shown as a man for the people. That is going to be an interesting thing to see if he's going to be the man for the people. So that's where it's going to be fascinating to watch and see if that happens. However, I will give him credit for this because I think it's important to say this one point. We have seen whether it was something where it was because his hand was forced or whether because it truly was the move of the Prime Minister to get out, to weed out any troubles, any issues. But he has had four cabinet ministers find themselves no longer his cabinet ministers. He has, I think, forced the resignation of Dr. Dwayne Sands and forced the resignation of Laneisha Rolle. I don't know. I can't remember if he forced the resignation of Peter Turnquest. But he has forced the resignation of those two. And the idea behind them was because they failed to live up to a standard. So then the question is, should we give the Prime Minister credit for this? And I think in part, yes. In part, yes. You can argue, which I would argue, that it's a little too late because there has been issues from time immemorial with the concerns with Mrs. Rolle and her leadership in both social services and then moving on to the Ministry of Youth. There could have been an opportunity when you had a magistrate, lambaste, will pretty much say in her written judgment that she believed that the involvement of Dr. Dwayne Sands and Marvin Dames was too onerous, was too much. You could have had that moment there as well. Mind you, I didn't think that it was enough for that to warrant that, but it was very much a damning thing. There is room there for these things. But I asked myself the question, in political season, in this time, everything must be watched with eyes wide open because there are adjustments. There are things that are moving, chess pieces that are moving. And so we have to be very much wide awake. At the end of the day, ladies and gentlemen, at the end of the day, politics will be politics. Politics will be politics, and the season is going to get more entertaining by far. By far, it's going to get more entertaining. But there are some things that we must be awake for. It will get funny. It will get entertaining, and we will get distracted for that nanosecond because some things you just can't hide, right? You cannot hide. Some things you cannot not laugh at and try to act like it's not a distraction. It will be a distraction. But there are things that we must stay awake for. One, what is the economic plan? What is the economic plan? Who has the best plan to get us out of this financial ruin we're in? All that shucking and jiving ain't gonna help us. All of that, making noise and talking about marching, that ain't helping us. Who has the best plan? That is what I'm looking for. So during all of this, we're going to have our good jokes and our laughs. At the end of the day, we must know who is coming with it. And I mean, they got to be detailed. They got to be on point. Because this is not a time. Now, they don't have to know everything from A to Z. But just that we have the confidence in their competency. That is what is going to be the thing that we argue on coming into the next year's 2022. Right? Do we have the confidence of their competency? We cannot be voting out of fear. We must vote in faith. And faith and in a formula. Are you able? See, charisma has gotten us a lot of what we are. You know, so the Bible talks about the wages of our sin is death. The wages of sin is death. But child, the wages of this corrupt country is all our politicians and ourselves being too weak to vote in intelligent, independent, right-thinking people who aren't just loyal to the party. So we have a lot of work to do. A lot of work to do. And so that's what we got to look for. We got to make sure that in our House of Assembly, that they are accountable. And when you do fool, we're going to call you out on it. You know, this isn't time to pat people on the back and make you feel good. It's going to be the hot seat. This is election season. Ain't no time for that. I would tell people, ain't no time for that. No time. All right, we got a call on the line. Let's take this caller before we go to break. Caller, you're on the hit back. Welcome.
Laneisha Black.
How are you?
Right now, I will say you meddling.
Say again?
Right now, I will say that you are meddling.
Oh, I... Okay, go ahead.
You're trying to make a call for constructive change.
Oh.
And it's not what we are used to.
Yeah, well, yeah, you might be onto something.
but at this stage, it is absolutely necessary, because we can actually be, we can be watching a parade,
mm-hmm.
and not know what is actually walking down the road.
Mm-hmm.
You know?
Yeah.
I listen attentively to how how this conversation pans out.
Thank you, my brother. I appreciate you.
Okay, good. Bye.
Take care. All right, we got some text messages. Ms. Black, tell Mr. Wells and his trolls worry about Bamboo Town. Oh, Lord. Y'all. I like Redwood. I think Redwood Wells is a nice guy. He just, his words were scintillating. Tell that first caller to go crawl back in his hole. Oh, Lord. Miss Black, don't pay sidewalk defending caller no mind. He never sees anything wrong with what this government does. So what if we want to talk and laugh at Wells' comments? Time to switch shows. Someone says, time to switch shows. Enough of this. Oh, Lord. I'm going to miss you. Whoever you are, I'm going to miss you. I am. It's just, that was heartbreaking there. We got another caller on the line. Caller, you're on the hit back. Welcome. Hello, caller, you're on the air. Hello. Okay, I think we may have lost the caller. All right. Someone says, Ms. Black, why are your listeners getting offended, though? Ah, Lord. Three birds and one sheep. Which is better, Renwood or Ferrero? Now, y'all, that ain't right. Y'all ain't right. Y'all, that wasn't nice. That was not nice. Come on, man. I like Ferrero, too. Three birds, one sheep will never live down. No, he can't live that down. That will go with him in infinity. I would have to say, if we had to do a deal on which one's words were worse, I'm going with testicular head. That's it. I'm going with that. That's a one. It's a winner. Ding, ding. So someone says, Ms. Black, the only thing that can take us out is the vaccine and that everyone takes it worldwide. The Bahamas was moving before Dorian and COVID. The entire world is in shambles. Very true. The entire world was in shambles. We had Dorian and then it led into this COVID pandemic. We were doing better. We were having some of our best tourism numbers. Now, the question is, was that growth that we were experiencing, I think it was 1.6%, 1.6 to 1.9%, that growth that we were experiencing, who was getting the lion's share of that growth? That's the question that we have to ask, because many people are still saying that, hey, listen, things were tight before Dorian and before COVID-19, but we were anticipating some sort of positive trend, and then Dorian kicked us in the gut. All right, we got a call on the line. Caller, you're on the hit back. Welcome. Hello, you're on the air.
Yes, I'm here. How are you, Nahaja?
I'm well, my brother, and you?
I'm fine, thank you, and good afternoon to the nation. I'd like to make a comment, and then I want to give you a meaning that I came across. Mm-hmm. With regards to what the Minister of Health said yesterday about the incompetent authority. Nahaja, I believe the verdict is already in. I don't think that the Bahamian people need to figure out who has the better plan, because this incompetent failed minister administration has been failing the Bahamian people over the last 4 years. And we don't need another year. We certainly don't need another term to figure out if he has the competency to get us through these very turbulent financial and economic times. We are seeing and experiencing through our very suffering, and we know that he does not have the vision, and he does not have the wherewithal, and he certainly doesn't have or supporting him in the cabinet to wherewithal to get us to where we need to be, right? And I'll end with this point. Testicular head, I came across the description that I believe suits him, right, based on what the Minister of Health says. Describing a person of low or no intellect whose testicular fortitude replaces their lack of intelligence. A person who freaks out at everyone in their workplace, resulting in said persons being terminated and physically removed, with the police being involved.
Where you found this definition? Y'all made this definition to sound like menacing. What y'all doing?
That's the top definition in the Urban Dictionary. Anyone can find it. That's the source.
I know. I watched. I read it on Urban Dictionary too. Thank you, my boy. I appreciate you. All right, we got a few more texts here. I want to get to. Someone says, "No, we cannot give the prime minister credit for those forced resignations, as they are all political moves on the political chessboard. Why wasn't the Miami consulate fired with the drama related?" Hey, that's a word. Now that's a word, because she was not fired. And boy, listen, she left a post and all. There's all kind of stuff happening in the Miami consulate. Fired with the drama related to the positive COVID-19 passengers. Right? Four undocumented humans on a flight. Right? Because it wasn't politically expedient for the PM. All right, so we got a whole other show to deal with. We could talk about these all day. This is the season we're in. Y'all stay woke, child. Stay woke. Stay woke. You don't have time for all of this dollar whining, as my husband is saying. Give me a dollar. Give me a dollar. Give me a dollar. You're listening to The Hit Back with Nahaja Black. When we come back now, Basic Investing 101. I'm excited. Are you? We'll be back after this. Bam!
I'm mad. About to get back. Need some get back.
This is Guardian Radio, 96.9 FM, Nassau, Bahamas.
You're listening to the Guardian News Network. Good afternoon, everyone. I'm Taylor Ferguson. Here's what's making news. Thank you for tuning in. Prime Minister Dr. Hubert Minnis says as much as he may want to call an election, he won't act alone and will be advised by his team. He was responding to St. Anne's MP Brent Simonet, who jokingly called for the Prime Minister to ring the election bell.
Simonet?
Ring the bell.
You think everybody ready?
Looking good. Yeah.
If you think they're ready, if you think they're ready, I'll stand here now and ring the bell.
Simonet made the comments as the Prime Minister gave an update on several hotels that are set to reopen in the coming weeks. The Prime Minister said, calling an election is not a decision he plans to make on his own. Opposition leader Philip Davis explaining a statement he made last week when he told reporters a PLP government would focus on tax reform and review value-added tax. He was asked today to clarify if he meant a Davis administration would be seeking to lower the rate of VAT below 12.5%.
It would be our intent to see how we could alleviate some of the burdens on the Bahamian people. And that consequent to that would be looking at it to see whether it could be lowered. But what the review of that VAT would be, the outcome of that will determine what we do at the end of it.
Inappropriate payments, lack of competitive bidding, and inadequate contract controls among several findings of an audit into a $10 million loan from NIB to the Ministry of Housing back in 2013. Minister for National Insurance Brenzel Rolle detailing several findings in his communication in the House of Assembly today.
Inappropriate payments were identified totaling $1,119,231. Included $417,249 of payments to contractors for unpaid work, $118,025 of duplicate payments to contractors.
And that's what's making news. I'm Taylor Ferguson. AP News is coming up next.
Coronavirus update. I'm Ed Donahue with an AP News Minute. The Dow finished with a record high today, up 424 points. With positive reviews from the Food and Drug Administration, Jeff Zients with the White House coronavirus team is preparing for approval for emergency use of Johnson & Johnson's one-dose coronavirus vaccine.
We anticipate allocating 3 to 4 million doses of Johnson & Johnson vaccine next week. Johnson & Johnson has announced it aims to deliver a total of 20 million doses by the end of March.
CDC Director Dr. Rochelle Walensky says the number of coronavirus cases is still high, but the trend is headed in the right direction.
In the past week, average daily cases declined 25% to approximately 64,000 cases per day. This is slightly less than the summer peak of 67,000 daily cases reported last July.
President Biden plans to distribute millions of face masks to Americans and communities hard hit by the coronavirus. I'm Ed Donahue.
Imagine. That's where every advancement begins, with an idea that things can be different, better, now. Imagine a world where your entertainment experience was all about you, your style, your show, at your budget. At Rev, that's what we've imagined. To join the conversation and learn more about the future of Rev TV, visit us at rev.bs/imagine.
Hello, sir. Your credit card bill is due. Hello, sir. It's time for your monthly loan payment. Tired of creditors pounding at your door? Sign up for a debt consolidation loan from Fidelity Bank and consolidate your debt into one low monthly payment. What's more, you'll also earn interest on a built-in savings account. The pandemic has curbed many freedoms, but at Fidelity, our focus is to help regain your financial freedom. Visit a branch or speak to Fidelity Bank at 356-7764. COVID safety measures in place at all branches. Fidelity, we're good for you.
Cancer is smart. It pushes us. We push back. Challenging conventional thinking, finding smarter solutions. That's what makes Cancer Treatment Centers of America one of the leaders in precision cancer treatment, using tools like advanced genomic testing and immunotherapy to bring more options to our patients. Cancer Treatment Centers of America, we're not just fighting cancer anymore, we're outsmarting it. Visit cancercenter.com/outsmart to learn more.
Listening to the Hit Back with Nahaja Black. All right, now we're shifting gears, y'all, because one of the things that we do here on the Hit Back every Wednesday now, we've been doing it from the beginning of the year, is that we are hoping every day to add more content and education to our financial portfolio, right? So we need to become more financially literate. Now to this week, we begin this week, and we'll have a part two next week. We are talking about investing, how to multiply your meager dollars, your minimal assets, your little change, right? We're going to be the people with the talents. One person going to bury it, the other one going to bury a dollar, one, you know, invest five. However that thingy went, yeah, we're going to make some money. We're going to multiply this thing. So I have joining me today, of course, you all know my good friend Nathaniel from Druber Solutions, who is here with us on the show. And then we have Lamont Astwood. You know, I like that rich name now, Lamont Astwood. CFA, thank you so much, Lamont and Nathaniel. I appreciate you both for being here with us. My topic, I'm so excited about this topic, and I'm glad that you guys are here. Let's talk about how do I multiply my $10? Because that's where I'm at. I'm in the law of multiplication. I've got subtraction going on. And then weekly paychecks called addition. They take too long to add up. So how do we begin to multiply our investments? So I'll start with you, Nathaniel, because I want you also in this introduction and introduce us to Lamont and what he brings to this conversation. But when we talk about investing, what are we talking about?
So great. So thank you for having us once again. And I'm happy that I'm able to bring my colleague, Lamont, who is the guru in teaching newbies about investing. So he's the guru, you know, if you go on his Facebook page, he has all kind of, this is the strategy, how to do this, and this is how you do that. So, and he's good for it. And I have a lot of people behind me saying, oh, it's about time you brought Lamont on.
That's right.
But so I just want to start off by saying that, to your point, when it comes down to investing, we first have to look at the different types of investing, investment opportunities that are before us. For some of us, we have the real estate investing, and then there's some areas and categories in that we'll dive into that a little bit later. And then you have what is now more popular, more trending, the security investing. Mm-hmm. And then you start talking about stocks, bonds, commodities, and the list goes on and on and on. And the mutual funds and the forex trading, all of that wonderful jazz. And then from there, we have what we call micro private equity. With micro private equity, you now focus on instead of establishing a startup, why don't you just buy into an existing company that is available? Get the books, understand it, and then you just buy into it. And then last but not least, you start getting into intellectual property. Now, that this is not that much common here in the Bahamas, but in other parts of the world where people will buy the patent for a particular invention in the States, and now they just live off the royalties from that. Mm-hmm. And so you have a lot of that going on in the States, movie rights, script mm-hmm. rights, book rights, and the mm-hmm. list goes on and on. And then last and the most final one, which is also a new trend here in the Bahamas, which is digital assets. And mm-hmm. out of all of the digital assets, more importantly, the cryptocurrency. So these are the five areas: real estate, securities, micro private equity, intellectual property, and digital assets.
Why you didn't send that to me earlier so I could write that down and put that on the screen? So we're gonna have to do all of that. You gotta text me that so I could stay on point. Text that to me. Let's get Lamont. Lamont, welcome to the show again. Now tell us, investing for you, you are looking at this conversation on investing, right? What are we, give me your point of view on it. And really piggybacking on what was said there.
All right. First of all, I want to say thank you for bringing me on. I'm really appreciative. I'm really grateful for this opportunity.
Man, my pleasure.
Well, it seemed like Nathaniel knows the stuff from listening to him in that short conversation just now. Like, I tell he knows mm-hmm. the stuff. Well, investing to me, like the first thing, like I'm in the CFA program. Let me give you a little background about myself. Mm-hmm. I have a bachelor's degree in finance from UB when it was COB. I'm enrolled in the CFA program. Right now I have one more level to go on that. So it's been a lot of extensive financial training via that route. But using that, I was able to apply a lot of that knowledge to real life investing opportunities. And I find that when you put your real money up, you learn much quicker as opposed to just reading out of a book. Like, yeah, lose right. money. When you lose money, you learn a lesson pretty fast.
Oh, yeah.
Like, I have mistakes I will never. And this is what I tell people, like, who's like to say, you know, I don't have enough money to invest. I like to tell them, you know, it's better to take a small loss and learn a lesson than to learn a lesson on a big loss. You know,
so I'd rather, true.
Like, I'd rather bump my toe than break my leg. Like, that's just how I feel about life. Mm-hmm. And one of the first things relating back to the CFA program, because it trains like wealth managers, asset managers. One of the first things they teach you as far as like dealing with clients is to find out your client's risk tolerance. Mm-hmm. So that's the willingness to take risk and the ability to take risk. Most individuals, they have to understand where they are in life. You know, like if you have a young guy who's 25 with no kids, you know, lives with his parents, he don't have as much responsibility as a 35-year-old with two kids who's in private school and a wife who he's supporting. Yeah. So their risk profiles are going to be totally different. And based on that, and also by your career, like all these things you have to take into consideration. That's why I like to tell people, if you come to me, like asking me, like, first of all, I don't give financial advice or investment advice. Mm-hmm. Like, I'm not licensed to do that, but I tell people you have to understand your circumstances. You can't apply your circumstances to everyone else's.
Everyone else's. Yep, that's right.
What works for Peter will not work for Paul. And also, as simple as like your career, if you have a high-risk career, you don't want to be in high-risk investments with a high-risk career. But if you have a more stable, like if you have a career where you could go 3 months without getting paid, you gotta put your money into something that could, you see what I'm saying? You have to put it into something stable. So that's why I say, like, that's the first thing when it comes to investing. You have to understand yourself. You have to know yourself before you go put money out there.
Yeah.
So.
Okay. Yeah. So if you're just tuning in, and I see we have our other guest, Khalil Brathwaite. I don't see Khalil isn't on camera. Khalil, are you there? Oh, nope. Okay, so we'll wait until he shows up on screen, off screen there. All right, guys, so then I think I see him. Khalil, are you there?
I am here. Hopefully you can hear me. I'm just leaving one meeting, getting stationary so I can put on my camera as nice as y'all. But I do love the
concept. I can give you more time if you need.
I definitely got to put on
Okay.
Go ahead. Sorry.
You may, I give you, as soon as your camera pops up, I'll see you so we can bring you on. No worries. So I'll give you as much time as you need because we're getting started and you can tune in, of course. All right. So we've got joining us today, if you're just tuning in, we are talking about basic investing 101. A very important topic because we have a lot of our listeners, as Nathaniel knows, who are ready now. We've talked a lot about saving. Oh, yeah. We've talked about the different ways to secure yourself. Now we people are adulting, right? So people, there's some folks who message me on the side saying, Hajiman, listen, I got money from, I left work, right? They gave me the package. The hotel shut down. I got a package. I have a piece of property on the family island. I'm trying to figure out what to do. Mm-hmm. Right. How to spend this money, how to invest this money. What should I do? So there's a lot of those questions. And my first thing is call Nathaniel. That would be my first thing.
Yes.
Call Nat and then figure out how to help you spend your money. But so I like what you said at the beginning, Nathaniel. And if you guys, we're kind of having some technical issues on the side, the radio side. So welcome back. You are tuning into the Hit Back with Nahaja Black on Guardian 96.9 FM. All right. So let's go to those five things. So let's continue with those five things that you mentioned. The first thing in terms of investment, you would say real estate investing. What is the basic investment rules in real estate? I love this topic, trust me. So I am going to start. I'll start with you, Lamont. Basic real estate investment rule. Where would you start?
Me?
For you, Lamont, yep.
All right. Well, I'm not really a real estate expert.
Okay, so you want me, I'll move on to Nat then, and we'll come back to you.
He's the securities guys.
Oh,
he's
the securities.
Yeah.
Oh, my stocks and bonds. Security.
Yeah, right, stocks and bonds guys.
The only thing I can say about real estate is God ain't making no more, so you might as well buy some, you know?
So with real estate, so there's several things that you have to take into consideration. With real estate, we have the opportunity to, of course, buy it and hold it. And then there's unique things that we can do with it. So if you have a piece of property, if you were gifted a piece of property, or even if you went to a family island and purchased a piece of property, there's three markets that you could focus on. You have the local market where you could rent to other Bahamians or other nationals, depending on the value of the home and where the location is, that will determine the price. You understand what I'm saying? The quality of the home will also determine the price that you could rent it for. So we have a number of Bahamians who may not have a lot of knowledge in regards to investing, but they understand this one principle. I'm going to get the duplex, I'm going to get the triplex, and I'm going to rent this out, and this is going to help me pay the mortgage. And so that concept, great. I would encourage Bahamians to even take it a step further. We are not in the States where you can get about 10 properties and the bank puts you, doesn't rock the boat. We at most could probably could get three, and the third one is with a partner somewhere who also
is
Max.
Who's your daddy, Nathaniel? Who's your daddy? And I need to know, how come you could do this and I can't do this? What I miss it?
But see, the key about it is this, is how much you're going to inject into the property in regards to the capital you're going to bring to the table. Now, the sad thing about it with real estate investing, and especially if you're going to finance it through some of our financial institution, I think where most persons get hold up is really at the collateral stage. Because what they're going to ask for collateral is almost the same value in the property that you're about to buy or purchase, plus more. That is the challenge. However, getting back to the point, you can invest. So the first level is the locals. The second level is the rental market to second homeowners. Let me tell you something. This has been here from the 40s and 50s. I've beat this horse till I can't beat it no more. It is not going anywhere. Yes, I know a lot of people want to move away from tourism, but I'll tell you one thing. A lot of tourists are moving away from big hotels, and they want to have a cultural in-person experience with the locals. And we are set up in such a unique way that everyone, when I say everyone, I'm talking about many of us who have roots and ties to family islands. So those islands in the central or in the south who people feel like is in the back of the bush and nobody cares about it, trust me, there are people Midwest who would want to travel there because they see it as a means of getting away and being in a position where they have no one has access to them. That's a vacation for them. Hmm. We got some people who have never seen a beach before. And so remember now, most family islands are set up Everybody's built on the edge of the island. So almost every property is beachfront or accessible to a beach. So for many of them, they would enjoy that experience. So that's the second market. And of course,
let me just make sure I get what you're saying. What you're suggesting is, if you got if you have property on the family island, put a little home on it.
Yeah, put a little cottage on it. And when I say a cottage or a home, you could put something that is about 850, 950 square foot. And that's not really big. What we call a shack here in Nassau, where we might underappreciate the value of it. You put that thing on the family island, you put a car there, and you give them access to probably some of the activities on that island. Now you've gone from having a property that generates no income but only expenses to now having a property that generates anywhere between 300, 400, and the list goes up, depending on what island you put it on. So you could put it in an Andres and get probably $200, $300 from it. You could put that same property, same size in Abaco, and probably if you have somebody stay there for a week, you could get $1,000. So like I said, it comes back to location, location, location. But then you have that third market, and this is the creme of the creme. Here in Nassau, the third market is the commercial space. You find that once you have a commercial building, now I can be very honest with you, it's not easy to obtain these type of buildings or to build these type of, or get the financing for these type of buildings. But once you build a commercial entity that has several store outlets and some of the store owners who are renting from you, some of the traditional business, and if you're lucky enough, you could get a major restaurant franchise like a Bamboo Shack or one of those other ones. Mm-hmm. And then you might even get a bank. You may even get number houses and, you know, all of that other stuff. But at the end of the day, you could literally sit back because that entity is literally going to be there for years, almost decades in a sense. They're not going to move. The turnover in commercial, depending on where you're renting and who you're renting to, is not as frequent as the turnover in the rental, the residential market. Mm-hmm. So there's opportunity. So they are the three areas when you talk about buy it and hold it. Now, there's also the opportunity strategy where you buy it.
Go over those three again.
So you rent into locals.
Yep.
So if I'm going to rent to the local market, say a single mother with one child or a single lady or a single guy, I'm going to put that in the most crowded areas, such like a Kamaika Road. Anything off Kamaika Road Strip, trust me, I'm telling you, duplex, triplex, people want that. Anywhere, somewhere out east, certain parts are out west, depending on the type of background that you're targeting. If you want to rent, well, right now tourism is down, but when tourism at its all-time high, having a rental space close to the bridge or having a rental space close to Malia or Bahama, you know, people run to those type of things because people who hate traffic don't mind going into those type of spaces. So renting to locals. And then we have renting to the second homeowners, or not second homeowners, to tourists coming to the country. And you'll be surprised how many persons make their living out of this space. Tour companies, fishing companies, the list goes on and on and on and on. And the challenge that we have in this area is every report says that we don't have enough activities for persons who are occupying these type of spaces. In addition to that, what makes matters worse is the fact that, like I said, the trend is most people are moving away from big hotels to wanting to go into these small spaces. Today, 10 years ago, there weren't many properties on online sites. Today, you can find a property in any major subdivision or developed subdivision in New Providence on an Airbnb or HomeAway site today. You understand what I'm saying? So we are not without excuse. You could even rent out a room in your existing house. And there are a lot of behemoths who have gotten into that. I tell the story all the time about this young lady who's literally the same age as me. And all she does is rent out the house that she has to tourists and drive them around all day. And when I heard how much she was making a year, I had to scratch my head, take out the lunch, and find out how I could get inside the space myself. So, you know, so that's
number one.
And then the third one, the last one, like it says, commercial space. Now, of course, COVID-19 has affected the commercial.
Yep. Did we lose him? Yep, we lost him. And it was so good, too. You just love how Benny freezes, definitely. And he freezes right in that spoken word.
And it's not like what it used to be. But oh, man. Yeah.
So
we're talking about real estate. And so that's and so all of those fall under buying the whole strategy. And then we have the other strategy, which is to flip it. So you buy a property that is probably undervalued, underdeveloped. You go inside there, you fix it up a little bit. You bring it to its true market value or even higher than its market value. And you sell it. You sell it to another owner who's looking to get into the space. And so you have literally, and here's the challenge. So you have novices who's trying to get into the space, and then you have some savvy real estate investors in this country. I mean, when the repossessed listing is made available, they go in there, they get those properties.
I have to ask, let me ask you this question on that, because to me, that's one of those areas that we don't get much. We know that it exists.
Yes.
Then the question is how to become a player when you aren't a player in the field. So you have the blind bids. And then you have what? Like how do folks get into
the first thing you need to do is there's several things you have to first have an understanding of. And there's no shame in if you get an assistance from a real estate agent. I will tell you, I'll be the first to say get a real estate agent, especially if it's your first rodeo, get a real estate agent involved. Select a lawyer or law firm that is probably good with a lot of the financial institutions because they have a list of law firms that they work with. And then once you, that's the first phase. The second thing is you need to make sure that you have a home, and I recommend this because I've heard too many horror stories and myself having experienced certain challenges in the area of construction and renovation. Get a home inspector on your team. You're just building your team. Lawyer, real estate agent, home inspector, and of course, the contractor. That's the first thing. And then the second thing you want to do is in your conversation with the real estate agent, now they're helping you craft the plan on what type of properties to go after, what type of markets are available. There are three major markets here in the Bahamas. I would call it those under 120. Very hard to get those type of properties. As those properties are on the list and you blink an eye, that is gone. And that's how hot the market is. And it's been hot like that and will forever be hot because that's what most persons can qualify for. But there's some beauties in that. And then, of course, you go over that 120 going into somewhere around the 350, 400 range. And very few people qualify for those type of properties. And so they're a little bit harder to move. And then, of course, after that, you're going into the $500,000, going into the $1 million property, to dealing with more luxury real estate agents who specialize in that. And that market,
There's a foreclosure market.
Of course. Let me tell you something. You know how much properties, depending on what island you're dealing with, do you know how much properties are being bought out in that space? So
we need to get a banker.
And I'm coming out and I'm saying it's one of the major economic activities inside the country is a real estate transaction. Let me come out and say that again. One of the major drivers of economic activities in this country is a real estate transaction. Yes. The law firm, the real estate firm, the insurance company, and the financial sector, all of them benefit off a real estate transaction. So I want to make that clear. So like I said, once you get your team together, the second thing is find out what you qualify for. Now, this is critical because once you understand what you qualify for, depending on what bank you want to go work with, I would normally tell persons, try all if you have the time. And if you don't, go with the banks where you have an account with them, an existing account. And now you're going to get involved with what they call the relationship officer. They're usually the officers who give you the loan. No, let's now form the relationship with them. So that now if there's an opportunity, one quick call to them. Hey, I got an opportunity. Do I still qualify for X, Y, and Z? And the answer is yes. That person is going to be on your side to speed up the financing for you to get the property. You get what I'm saying?
Yeah, and that works because, for the record, just as a note on your loan officer, they are working for a commission, and plus they have a sales quota, right?
Oh, yes.
And that sales quota stresses them the halo out. So they are ready and willing to help you if they can. All right, we're going to take a quick break. When we come back, because Lord knows in my head, all I'm hearing now is I know exactly who I need to bring on for my real estate investing show. I know exactly who. I got this realtor and I got these all about invest. I got this person in my head. We're going to dive even deeper here because that foreclosure thing is a real thing. And I think a lot more Bahamians.
Big.
And the rent-to-own market, and that's also growing. Listen, there's opportunities here. I have my neighbor. He lost his father and he has a home. His father left a home. And I'm thinking, dude, you're rich because you got a home. And plus daddy left you one. I should marry him off. I actually am going to put him on some sort of site and get some change for him. He's good. He's a good character. All right. We're going to take a quick break. When we come back, let's switch gears. We got a lot more things to talk about. Yeah. So I want to talk about securities investing. But this real estate one can be a whole show by itself. It's fantastic.
Each one of these points.
And listen,
we can dive into great detail.
And I think that's what we're going to have to do. We're going to take one show. We're going to do one show and do a part of that investing just on that show because these are very much important ones. We're going to switch gears to the securities one because Lord knows I'm trying to get all of this in an angle. You're listening to The Hit Back with Neharja Black. When we come back, we'll be joined by Lamont Aswood, Nathaniel Butler. I was going to say Druba Solution, Nathaniel Druba. We'll be back after this.
For the past 33 years, Great Commission Ministries has been defending the poor and hurting, feeding the hungry, and sheltering the homeless. We invite you to support our Live to Give program and make a difference in these challenging times. Become a donor by giving a one-time annual gift or a monthly donation of $50 or $100. Call Great Commission Ministries at 325-5801 for more details. Or visit our headquarters at 237 Wolf Road. Join Live to Give today. This public service announcement is proudly sponsored by this radio station.
Are you ready to break up with your car? Easy Car Sales invites you to fall in love with an electric vehicle. Ditch the gas pump, the expensive mechanics, feel the freedom, the power. Visit easy242.com and make a date to test drive an electric vehicle today. Get into a better relationship. Find your perfect match at Easy Car Sales and drive electric happily ever after.
Tired of banks forcing you to use technology to bank the way they want you to? Your convenience is important. So no matter what your banking needs, Commonwealth Bank's friendly staff are always available in branch for that personal one-on-one service. But when you choose technology, our online and mobile banking app offers you state-of-the-art functionality. The choice is yours. Commonwealth Bank. Bank the way you want.
Revenge. I'm mad. About to get back. Need some get back. Payback. Payback. That is.
Payback. And we're back. You're listening to The Hit Back with Neharja Black. It's a beautiful day here in the 242. It is 5:33. On this beautiful Wednesday. Yes, it's Wednesday. We got Nathaniel Butler from Druba Solutions and we've got Lamont Aswood. We're talking about basic investing. Basic investing 101. I wouldn't say it's, what do you call it? The something's guide to investing. What do they call it? I can't remember what it is. That something's guide to investing. The dummy's guide to investing. I don't know how dumb we have to be for this one, but it's pretty easy. And I'm excited to have both of them on the show. I see we lost Khalil, so hopefully we can get him back. But if not today, then next week, of course, as we continue the conversation. We have been talking, Nathaniel and Lamont, you being the first time guests on the show, we have been talking about investing, about money for weeks upon weeks. And now it culminates with our discussion on what to do with the money that we are going to learn to save in our 52-week challenge and all of this other stuff. So then let's move. We were talking about real estate investing, which is a show in and of itself. And I think you were, you were with me when we did the show with Matt Sweeting. Right now?
Yeah, of course. Hey, that's my colleague. We come together and that's what we do. That's what we do.
And listen, when I tell you that was a great show, it's still one of my best shows. People, we repeat that a lot just so the folks can get that information out there. But now let's switch gears, because real estate investment, that is going to carry a huge chunk of information and strategies and how to approach the bank when we talk about we want foreclosure properties or when we want to learn how to create that contract for a rent to own property. Those are the type of minutiae we would love to get into. If you have
and the taxes.
And the taxes, right? What about condominiumization?
Yeah, and people, yes.
You know, that process, right? So we have so much information on real estate investing that we have to get into. And also for those who want to do vacation rentals, you know, what is the technique? How do you get those guests to come in droves? So that's where we were going to talk about really with real estate investing, how deep we need to get into for that. So I don't want to belabor that point too much. So the next one then is securities investing. Well, I know Lamont ready. Lamont Baird is like hard money's about to shoot a three. So Lamont got this. That's when it's on a hot streak, right? So right. Lamont, let's talk about securities investing. What is it and who can get involved in this?
All right. Well, securities investing, usually it falls into two categories, right? You always hear people talk about like stocks and bonds, right? But there are like tens. There are a bunch of different securities you get into. Like you get mortgage-backed securities, convertible bonds, stuff like that. But that's like real estate. That could be a whole segment. That could be a whole show on itself. So what I'm going to do is I'm just going to speak on stocks and bonds. Now, remember what I said earlier with regards to risk tolerance as far as investors? Usually that goes with how an individual should invest, because bonds tend to be less risky than stocks. I started to ramble. Let me explain exactly what is a stock.
I was going to ask you.
All right. A bond is just a contract between a lender and a borrower. So let's say, all right, Miss Black, she has a company and she wants to raise money. Now, she doesn't want to necessarily give up ownership of her company, right? So she will issue debt to investors. And me, as Aspen Enterprises, I would buy the debt from Black Enterprises and we would get paid via that route. Now, the benefit to you is you get to keep 100% ownership of your company. You get to control what your company does. Now, that's basically what a bond is. Now,
over time, you pay. Okay, go ahead. Finish your thought.
So, now, as time goes, you pay me like interest rates. Then at the end of our contract, let's say it was a 10-year maturity. At the end of that, if you borrowed $1 million from me, you'll give me the $1 million back. And also, I was getting whatever interest payments you were paying along the way. Mm. You see, so that's what usually bond investing does. And the coupon payments
I just wanted to ask, can a bond investment happen? Because we normally think of bonds that happen with, say, for example, central bank, right? So there's their type of bonds. What other companies? So can companies, do you find that companies are doing bonds in terms of selling their debt? And can any company approach the market and say, I would like to sell my debt to it? Or are there prerequisites or types of companies that can do this?
Usually, it's almost similar like with issuing shares. They usually have to be a certain size and they'll have to go through a process. They'll have to be approved. They can't just wake up and do it unless they do it like in a private route, like a private investor. But when you're issuing shares to the public, it has to go through like the Securities Commission, Central Bank. It has to go, it's more stringent that way.
Okay.
But companies, you have a lot of companies that issue shares and debt, really. It depends on just their goals and how they plan to position themselves. Usually when a company does that, it sends off indicators about the company. Like some companies, they could do it and it's not really a big deal, but if you see a company that's issuing too much debt to the market, it is a red flag sometimes, because it's like they have to keep on reissuing it. It's almost like someone will have to keep on borrowing money, you know? Like what you doing, you know? Like what you doing,
right?
Bond investing. Sorry.
Go ahead.
Bond investing is seen as being a lot safer on the investor's part as opposed to like stock investing. Now, with stock investing, when you invest in a share of a company, you're buying essentially a percentage ownership of the company. So if a company issues 4 million shares and you buy 400, as small as it might be, you are a part owner of the company. I'm not saying you could retire and just live off the profits of the company. No, that ain't happening. But you are essentially an owner of the company. Now, companies that issue dividends. Mm-hmm. Sorry, Ms. Black, you had a question?
No, but you finish that thought because I have a question and I don't want to derail you from your thought. So yeah, companies that usually issue dividends.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, they'll issue dividends like if they have a good year. And also it depends on what the company's plans are. Like if the company plans to expand, they're going to need that money. So they might not issue a dividend to investors. And investors, like very intelligent and institutional investors, they tend to buy stocks and shares based on strategies they want to use. So certain companies, what might be a good stock, let's say like Apple, people would consider Apple a good stock, but you have investment companies that wouldn't invest in it because it doesn't sync up with their investment strategy that they're trying to implement. So it's so much you can get into. Well, in the Bahamas, we do have a stock market. We have the Bahamas International Securities Exchange, what has about approximately like 30 or so companies. And also it has publicly traded debt as well. Mm-hmm. So you can like buy bonds from companies on the exchange. I discussed it with Mr. Butler earlier. Like I work at the Securities Commission, so I can't really give advice on which ones to buy. Right. So it's like, that's why the information I'm giving is kind of surface level. You know, I can't really dive in and say, okay, get 300 shares.
I wonder if my new guest that just showed up is able to give me that bit of information though. I gather based on his company, he might tell me the same. I want to just, if you're just tuning in, ladies and gentlemen, I want you to know that you are listening to The Hit Back with Laneisha Black. We are talking about basic investing, 101 guide to investment in the Bahamas. This continues our educational series. We have with us Lamont Astwood joining us on the show. We have my friend Nathaniel Butler. And now, he's from his other meeting and he looks all shiny and new. Mr. Khalil Brathwaite is also joining us on the show. Guys, with this idea of securities, and welcome, Khalil. Good to have you on, buddy. All right, it's a pleasure. So
thank you for having me.
I'm excited to have all of you on the show because this particular area of securities is very interesting to me, right? The security side of investing, because when we start talking about crypto and on the market there, when we start talking about foreign exchange investment and trading, all of that things, those are in that digital space. I call it the ethers, you know? And I find that securities investing
right,
is also...
Right, right.
Yeah, seemingly in that otherworldly space, right? So we're talking about CNBC, mm-hmm. Bloomberg. This is where it gets interesting for me. I'm curious. I'm looking at local markets, right? We were talking about stocks and bonds. And I look at an investment or an opportunity like, I don't know, we call it an investment or an opportunity, but an entity like the cruise port, what we have now, right? The cruise port, I don't know, and you guys can tell me, have the shares been made public to the Bahamian people yet? Or are we still going through a process or something? Anyone knows if it's open yet to the public?
I don't think it is. It might be wrong.
No, sorry. All right, Khalil, you go with that one.
All right. Well, first of all, glad to have you. Thank you, audience, for bearing with me. It's been interesting. I will take the shiny comment because I know I'm sweaty. It's been a mad race. I'll take the positive spin on it. So, it's very interesting when we talk about investing and really, you know, how things come about. And it's kind of like when you tackle one question, it's like an onion. We're kind of peeling back layer after layer to really get at the core of what's happening. So in terms of the cruise port, yes, the cruise port is open, but that isn't what's interesting about that offering is it's a two-part offering. So there's the bond part, and then there's there's going to do a stock. The bond part has been offered and active where they've been receiving institutional money. And so that is for those who are looking for bonds. And bonds are just a fancy way of saying a loan where the lender is the investor and the borrower is the company. It, by definition, it's a contractual repayment principle and interest. And if you look at the definition of a loan, it's a contractual payment. It's just that the money is raised on the market side. So the bond off the port has been open and offering its shares in that. And I think what that does is a good example of what a very big national deal could involve, something that is so big that it gets a lot of exposure. For me, technically speaking, I like to get more into the nuts and bolts of a particular offering and kind of go back over those layers. But I think in the Bahamas we're caught in a nice catch 22, and we're seeing a lot of movements in the unregulated world, which would be crypto and all of that, pushing towards the regulated world, which would be kind of be the sand dollar and digital currency being adopted.
Yeah.
And we've had snippets of true market potential here. I think what the Bahamas is very, we're caught in a catch 22, right? So we do have a stock market here, and stocks are great investments, but what the Bahamas is kind of suffering from is a critical mass issue, which allows the stock market to operate in a true proper fashion. Our market is not liquid, and liquidity is just a fancy way of saying how easy it is to convert cash from the audience that are listening. And so we don't have enough people playing in the game, and I should say game. We don't have enough people participating in the stock market to allow people to buy and sell extremely easy. And that's where we kind of are in a point. So there's a whole evolution of the economy and the markets itself growing big. Because in the Bahamas, traditionally, stocks would be buy and hold. And you hold forever, and you give to your grandkids. And then you would kind of get, mind you, there's been activity where you can offload something quickly, but a big part of investing is the human element. So people have to believe and want to buy that and want to sell that. So we're suffering from a critical mass issue in terms of having enough people participating in the market to allow the liquidity that it wants. But what's also happening is that, and my friend touched upon it, you know, usually when a market, when a stock is brought to the market, it does it for two or three reasons. A, to raise capital. B, to kind of solidify its customer base. You know, I think the more people buy my shares, they'll shop with me. And then you kind of have this illusion of non-stock potential growth. Well, I'm sorry, every business, you know, plateaus, right? And every business gets to a point where it gets to a certain full valuation. And the way in a sophisticated market you would compensate for that is the dividend that would come from a stock, because that's your form of profit sharing, which our other panelists kind of mentioned. So this full circle of benefits is critical to be understood, but it starts with A, critical mass, and B, having belief in the market itself. And so we're caught in a very catch 22, because in the Bahamas, the word securities is a very broad term, and the word investing is a very broad term. So, you know, if you tell someone about securities investing, they'd be like, yeah, man, I want to open a security patrol firm. They make plenty of money. Not that type of security. You know, it's investing. So there's a whole learning curve. Now, what we've seen is those who understood it have benefited from it, but the market needs to buy in. And anytime the market doesn't buy in completely, it can feel betrayed based on what it was expected. Now, it's all about how you communicate what is expected. But I think we in the Bahamas, I always say, you know, we're so close to the America and England and all of that. We have first world cases. It may put us in a third world category, but everyone in the Bahamas know about first world cases, first world markets, first world. So we right there on the cusp of seeing things happen. And we may not expect it to happen locally, but there we are trying to kind of connect the dots. What's going on. And I think what's also causing a lot of problems is that a lot of the words overlap securities, and now you have cryptocurrency coming out at the same time as a central bank digital currency.
Yeah.
And you have crypto behaving like a commodity when central bank, CBDCs or sand dollars aren't a commodity, just the digital version of the dollar pocket. So it's really about leveling the conversation and the leveling of the understanding so people can comprehend and connect dots. But as I start from where I kind of sit and pull these pieces together, I have an interesting point of view. But I probably talk too much. I compensated for getting on late and being shiny.
No. Don't worry. I'm always shiny, and I wasn't doing anything to sweat, so I don't even know what you're talking about. Just have a great background, and you blow in my voice.
I just think funny.
All right. So you know what's so interesting about this, and I'm so glad we're having.
Nathaniel will tell you I like a good.
A good ribbing, eh? Well, then you're my kind of guy, man, Khalil. So, guys, this is where it gets interesting for me, right? I love what I heard because now I'm excited because all I heard was, boy, Nahash, you have some crazy good shows, maybe. This is going to be good. Here is where I'm curious. My curiosity now is peaked, right? We're talking about security. So I'm listening to now I know that my good friend Atwood is, you know, working for the, you know, Securities Commission now, right? So Atwood got a line. He can't say much after. He can't say too much, right? So I know my friend can't say too much. Atwood.
Oh, yeah, he's a regulator. He's the police in our industry.
Yeah. He's the feds on the panel. So when we do start talking he's crypto, Mr. Atwood got a pause. And then we got Khalil. Khalil is like, listen, let's break the door down, man. We gonna get this.
That's so funny. So,
go ahead. Oh, we lost. Did we lose Khalil? All right. So then, and let me try because I know we have so much going on. Go ahead.
No, there was a distance.
Yeah, finish your thought there, Khalil.
Yeah. So the thing, folks, is a very interesting thing. So I don't know, man. My friend, because I know he can't comment, but Securities Commission is like writing the policy and framework to govern it under the DARE bill, and so they, you know, because they have to protect the investor, the everyday investor, so their role is much more prudent than people imagine. They're not worried about the sophisticated investor because they understand sophisticated investors supposed to have some degree of knowledge and understanding. It's the everyday investor and ensuring the integrity of a deal from end to end on every deal that comes in the market. So with crypto, it becomes very interesting because they've been proactively trying to address the issue and see where it is. The definition of crypto is very interesting by definition because crypto was born in a transaction that operates
Khalil, under the breaking up so much.
Decentralized market. So for them to now.
Yeah, you're breaking up so much, Khalil. Okay, I'm going to, let's see if we could switch right there while you deal with your connection there. I want to ask this question then, because I know when we have this discussion on the cryptocurrency investment or our digital currencies, the sand dollar versus the crypto.
Is this better?
Your audio is better by far. Your audio is better. Your camera is a little wonky, but we can deal with that. Let me ask you this, Lamont, before we lose time, right? Let me ask Lamont this question. Yes, it did help quite a bit with the audio. Lamont, if we are looking at let's take away from your work, but in your field of study, I'm curious, and Khalil, you guys will tell me too. If I am to look at the preferred shares or common shares, this is what we hear when we talk about the investment with the poor, preferred or common. And I want to know, because listen, I'm thinking, listen, this is long-term. Y'all can tell me now, this market ain't liquid. I'm trying to figure out now if I should be investing in a non-liquid market. I ain't trying to hold shares forever. I would rather than, you know, because the BIS6 don't excite me at all. I won't even lie. BIS6 don't excite me. I don't get it. I don't get excited. I don't get turned on. There's no testicular, nothing going on. Nothing happened. sorry, I couldn't help it.
I will laugh.
Forgive me. It just took the show down 2 notches. But anyways, I don't get excited. So I want to learn. I want my audience to know what is the difference between the common and the preferred share. Because that is what we're talking about when we're talking about, you know, get involved and buy stocks and this is for the Bahamians and blah, blah, blah. Okay. Tell me now so I could learn something and figure out if I'm promoting this transaction.
All right. Well, with common and preferred shares, a lot of it has to do with like voting.
I'll let any of my colleagues take the answer.
Go ahead. Go ahead, Lamont.
All right. Well, common and preferred shares, a lot of it has to do with the voting rights of the company. And I tell people sometimes, like, that's usually like when you really playing with like big money. Because you know, like, you have comp. Yeah. I'm not sure. That's where like certain people buy like X percent in a company. So it's be like, okay, we want to have a little bit of restructuring or whatever. And they just be doing like these box shady deals and all of trying to block certain stuff. So it's like, yeah, it happens, you know? It happens. Like, when you have like certain investors who get too big in a company and decide, like, listen, we want to change this, then you have the other investors trying to block that. Like, it's a lot. But usually with common and preferred, I think it's preferred shares, if I can remember, that's the one with no voting rights. I'm not 100% sure. Yeah, I think that's the one with
preferred, no voting rights. Preferred has no voting rights, but common has voting rights. Now, I see you. I see your mouth moving now.
Go ahead, Khalil. I'll piggyback on what you have to say.
Yes. Sure. So basically, it's one of those things where they need you, right? Because you have a common share and you have a share. But what a common share is you actually are an owner in the company. And as a result, your value of your share is connected to the value of the company. Mm-hmm. And because you have value in that company, you have voting rights. And so you have, you know, a vote to count. A preference share is really a tactic to raise funds from the market, but the way they use preference shares is a way of ranking the debt amongst its existing debt. So you can have a company that has ordinary shares, right, which you own piece of the company. You have a company that has bonds where they have like a debt. And then you have a preference share, which is literally if a bond and a share had a baby, it would be the same thing, because when you buy a preference share, you don't have any voting rights. The price you buy it in is locked in, pretty much a fixed rate of return. It's that you bring it up because common you shares. Purchase it on this perspective of the market, they call it a different thing. Huh. So it's good to kind of understand. And again, this is where the terminology overlaps. But common shares, meaning I am a shareholder, ordinary shareholder. That might probably be sound even better, an ordinary shareholder. That means I'm tagged to the value. So if I buy it for a dollar and it goes up, share is worth $100. All of that is, I'm tied to the ride. I am tied to the ride. Yeah. What a preference share does is basically saying, hey, we need to raise this capital and we want to offer some participation. So when I buy that preference share, I get a fixed rate of return. That company can go up tenfold. It does not matter. I get a fixed rate of return. Still 1 year. The reason it becomes very powerful, though, is in the event of this default, the preference shares carry
common shares are last.
Get paid first. And so there's a great enticement of saying, you know, a preferred share means I don't benefit from the price appreciation going up. But I am protected in case something ever happens, and I guaranteed return. And it becomes a tactic by the companies to intake some of the bond on. So that would be the difference between an ordinary share
and
a byproduct. So, and this is such a bad way to explain it. But if a bond and a share had a baby, it would be a preference share.
No, that's really like good illustration. Okay, all right. No, but I was going to say from the investor side, go ahead.
Yeah, you saw the time, right?
Yeah.
That shocked me too. It's crazy how quickly time flew. It's 5:58. And I know my producer's playing the music. I don't even have to hear it to know he's playing the music. We will have to continue this. And when we do, we'll start at the top of the show next week, Wednesday. Khalil, Lamont, I hope that you both are able to join me again, Nathaniel and I again, because we haven't even scratched the surface.
I gotta meet Khalil, man. He knows stuff.
I'm excited to be. We have to do this, and you know, hopefully, we get it all, you know, all done and down. Thank you guys so much for joining the show. You're listening to the Hit Back with Nahaja Black. Special thanks to Lamont Astwood. Special thanks to Nathaniel from Druba Solutions and Khalil Brathwaite. Thank you guys so much for joining the show. We are out. We'll see you tomorrow. Stop it.
Friday, right?